Yeah, good evening everyone. I just hope that I am audible by all, in just in case someone can tell me. Now I would like to thank the Isola Hyderabad for the invitation. Narasimha, my friend, and just now I came to know that Nanu Shastri is also here. He is my friend, philosopher, guide. I am landscape architect because of him. So today's talk, this actually the first slide that you see is basically my description. This is where I had spent my childhood. This is the northeast part of India in Arunachal Pradesh. Born in Shillong, and we had spent considerable amount of time here. These are the kind of landscapes I like to see, we like to design. Often we don't get the opportunities. So today we are going to talk about, not about my projects. I don't want to discuss my projects or describe my projects. But the talk is more about the defining moments in life. For example, whoever is practicing, there are times in your life when you meet someone and he changes your perception of, or your thought process, or he tells something which has got a profound impact on how you have been practicing or whatever you have been doing. Lucky are the people who get the chance to meet such people. And I would probably say that I was one of them. Right from the time I had filled up my form for the landscape course, incidentally, I had filled up urban design, and when I was just about to submit my form, I came across Nanu Shastri ji. And when he looked at the form, he said that he gave me a whitener and he said, you cut this urban design business and make it landscape architecture. And that's how I came into this field of landscape architecture. Otherwise, I would have been an urban designer, and I'm extremely grateful to him. So when we are talking about the defining moments of life, we all of us know that our experiences are shaped by the places we have lived, the schools we have studied, the people we have come across, the family members, everyone. But there are certain people who come across at different phases of life when they, even though you have been successful somewhere, they make you think, they make you stop, they stop you. So one thing which I realized after 30 years of practicing in this profession is that, you know, in all the institutions of architecture, landscape architecture, everything that is being pumped into your mind is external knowledge. And only when you are in a position to, you know, relate that to your inner experiences and feeling, then some kind of a relationship is established. Otherwise, everything is being hammered. Most of us, now for example, this I'm saying because whenever I go to colleges and listen to the students, I find that when they talk about their concepts, they are absolutely correct on the dot. But when they translate the same concepts into designs, there is a miserable failure. And that is where I feel that you know, there's a big gap between the external knowledge which is being transferred and the internal inner experiences and feelings which a person has been able to develop over the years. I think the role of institutions is predominantly, they are teaching you driving. So once they have taught you that, they have taught you about everything about the rules, regulations, how to drive, about the man machinery, or how to negotiate, but you are the actual driver. So when we passed out from the college, we felt that I wanted to have a roller coaster ride. I think everyone does. I didn't want my life to unfold in a very subtle way. We thought that there is lots to do. And fortunately for us in those days, I'm talking about 89, 90, there were hardly any landscape architects in India, leaving aside about five or six of them. So the field was wide open. Projects were in plenty. And that was the time our batch came into picture. And even out of that 14 people, maybe one or two people stayed back in Delhi, and rest of them moved out to different parts of India. So talking about being on the highway, when I started, I thought it will be a roller coaster ride. Soon I realized that it's like the reality was that you're driving on a city road. And at some given point of time, we were able to make it to the highway. The unfortunate part of the highway is that if you're driving too fast, you miss the scenery. And if you're driving too slow, everyone overtakes you. And 30 years of wisdom, the only thing I've learned is that you should take the routes which are less traveled. So I wish to talk about some of the people who had at certain phase of life had changed our way of thinking when we made the presentations to them. So before that, I just would like to talk about these five things which I had learned. And I just thought that if I just stick to these five things, maybe my practice would be more successful. So everyone, all my professors, people I had interacted with had talked about the history. And everyone said that you need to learn from history. I would like to quote by Professor Shahir. And once he was telling me that there is absolutely nothing new which is being done in the world today. The finest of everything that you can think of has already been done in history. Now it is up to you. You don't have to recycle it. You have to learn from it and use it to, based on your wisdom, to the present context. Everyone has talked about the fact that the spaces, whenever you happen to experience them, use all your senses. When I joined architecture in the very first year, on the very first day, we had a professor by the name of S.D. Chhaya. He is still there in probably in Gujarat. And he had told us the example of a temple, because that is the only building where you experience that building by using all your senses. You take out, there is a lot of ornamentation, storytelling on the facade so that you can see it. You take out your shoes so that you can feel the ground. There's always a temple bell so that you can hear it. While you walk through the passages of light filtering through different areas, you reach the place where the deity is. You get something to eat, so that sense of taste and sense of smell also comes into play. So the first thing we were told in SPA first year is that you keep your senses open. Be conscious of where you are, what you are seeing, and that is what, to a great extent, I have made an effort to follow in my life. Then everyone said that architecture has to be learned from various art forms. Every art form has something to contribute to architecture. And in the later part of the study, we'll see how it has been done when I met some of these greatest personalities in the field of dance or music. Even photography, poetry, painting, everything is of immense importance if you want to succeed at a later part of your life. Then learning from the people, places, cultures, environment, I think is the greatest challenge. The learning goes on and on. Even today we are learning about it. And the most important thing which Professor Shahir always used to say is that your landscapes are only going to be meaningful provided you have a symbolic meaning attached to that. Otherwise, what you are going to do all your life is it's a very mediocre kind of an experience. Now I'm going to talk about some of the, at least about 10 people who had really made a change in my life. I had already talked about Nanu Shastriji, who had an immense impact on my life. And he's the person I keep meeting. He has got such a huge house that he has got a full floor to live if I happen to be in Bangalore. So now, one of the persons I met in the very early stages of my life was Arjun Sharma. His father was the chairman of Sita Travels, and in those days, I'm talking about 91-92, there were very, very few hospitality industry people who were there. And everyone said that if you're working for Arjun Sharma, then you know he's like a Subhash Ghai who would launch you. So the first meeting could not take place. He described the site to me. He said that he has got a piece of land in Goa. The resort was already developed. But between the high tide line, what is known as the CRZ regulation zone, he said that we want that area to be done. So it was almost like 80 meters by 500 meters of an area, which was like a sandy beach, which was to be developed. He gave me a free hand and he said, you can design whatever you wish. Make sure that it is appealing to the people. So, you know, this was a challenge that I was looking at, because we had done most of the projects which were kind of residential or farmhouses or something else. So doing a hospitality project, that too in Goa, was a great experience. So we started the design, and probably had in a week's time, I had the first interaction with him. The design that I had prepared probably had almost everything that one could have imagined. We had a flea market, we had lagoons, we had a mini golf course, anything that one could think of or from the tourism perspective, and we had plenty of land, scenic site, lot of activities happening on the beach. We had play courts. It was the experience of being on a carnival street all over. So I described everything to him. He generally seemed that he was liking everything. And when I had finished, he said, "I have really liked everything that you have done, but what you have done is for today." Then he told me about how the concepts of hospitality are changing so rapidly. And he said that 20 years later, these things probably will not hold good. Second thing what I learned from him is that, you know, you have to appeal to the sensibilities of the guest for a longer duration, not just for a day or two. So if you want to hold a guest in your resort for a long duration, something has to go beyond what I had provided. So then he asked me, "Can you design a paddy field for me?" He gave me the example of the finest hotel sometimes in 91, 92 in China, which was awarded as the best hotel property in the world. And that had a picture, what you see below. This was a hotel which was overlooking a landscape like this. The people enjoyed it. There was no landscaping as such which was done. The hotel sat at a distance and all the rooms were overlooking toward these kind of paddy fields. And every day morning, the people would get up, put on their shoes, boots, and then they would go into that slushy area, plant paddy, and there would be water buffaloes moving in different directions. So two lessons I learned from him. I don't really know why I didn't do this project, because, you know, the biggest challenge I probably felt at that time, which we could not solve, is how to retain water on a sandy surface. So we did make a design for a paddy field based on the, you know, suggestive images that he had seen. And this is the kind of landscape I was born. We only had paddy fields and small hillocks all around. So we did make a design for that. But somehow the technical part of that, I was not in a position, I didn't have the knowledge base as to how the water is going to be held, or what do you do with the paddy fields? How do you cultivate rice? So somehow we did make that. I'm not sure whether this project was executed with the paddy fields or not, but the sketch that I developed for him helped me in getting lots and lots of work. I lost that sketch, otherwise I would have shared it here. But obviously it was like a plot from the Masala Hindi movie. It had almost everything beautifully presented. And for the later part of my life, I had shown that to various people and did get a lot of work. One of the benefits that we had in between 90 and 2000 was that there were a lot of competitions which were happening. And every year we used to participate. Irrespective of whether we did it alone or we participated with some architect or we did it in collaboration. And this was one of the very important competition, which was called the August Kranti Udyan. It was the brain of Narasimha Rao. And incidentally, three entries were shortlisted for this area. We were one of them. Probably the other one was Abhimanyu Dalal. And the interesting part was we came across Shivnath Prasad as a jury member in this particular competition. Most of us know that he was working with Corbusier and then he had moved on to US. But for this particular project, he had come here and he had a lot of things to offer us, to tell us about this. The most important thing is that, you know, we had the theme was Quit India Movement. We had Vastu Purush Mandala. And finally, he told me that, you know, you have to establish the relationship between Vastu Purush Mandala and Quit India Movement. We talked about, you know, establishing peace or probably searching for the peace. But then he finally said that, you know, this answer has to be, you have to think about it and we don't need an answer. But if you are able to incorporate that in your design, it will be much better. On the next year, we met one personality. His name was Pandit Birju Maharaj. He is a person I can talk about him almost for the whole day. If you happen to meet him, he has got a divine presence. So we designed a Gurukul for him. It was an architectural project on a almost like a 2000 square meter plot. And he had a set of requirements. And incidentally, I would say that after meeting him, I used to work in offices I was doing my own practice and I was also working in other offices. And after meeting him, he had such a profound impact on me that I left all the other jobs and just focused on my practice after that. So one of the very interesting things which I found him doing at one point of time was that he would dance, and out of that 1,000 ghungroos that he had in his feet, it would eventually come down that only one or two would make sound. So after he had finished, I asked him whether is it a matter of controlling his feet, and he said that you don't have to control your feet, you have to control your mind. He said, I can make 5 ghungroos sound or 10 or 11 or 12, not by virtue of being able to control my feet, but by controlling my mind. And he said that even while you design, it is not how you sketch, but what is going on in your mind actually makes all the difference. One more thing which he told me, which completely surprised me, was about, you know, he said ki dance and landscape architecture is exactly alike. Now, this is something which I just could not digest. How can the dance be and landscape architecture are exactly alike? So he explained, he said that while you are designing, you have got a person, you are wanting to tell a story to him. So you design his circulation accordingly. He focuses on certain objects which are of importance to him. There are certain places from where he can view the surroundings. And then he moves. And finally, when he has reached his destination, you provide him a full panoramic view of the landscape that he has created so that, you know, he can get a feel of the entire experience that he has had. Now, coming to dance, he said that we have set of people who move around in different directions. By virtue of moving their hands, they create a volume around it. They move in different directions, so we also create a plot in which we perform. Now the storytelling starts. And we tell the story, and instead of framing the views, we ourselves get framed in that. I felt that, you know, there are a lot of things he talked about, the difference between Indian and Western dance and how is the dancing of boys different from girls. For example, he said that while the girls can have the liberty to dance, the boys, the best kind of dancing is like when you hold a kite in your hand and the kite is also stationary and the thread in your hand is also stationary, but the whole rope in between shakes. So he said that a male dancer should just be able to stand in one position and he should be able to make the other people sway without doing anything. And I think he himself is a classic example of how that can be done. He can just sit like that. He's sitting here in one position and he can describe the whole life of Krishna sitting there. And the most interesting thing which happened with him is that when we had prepared the design for him, I presented the whole design. It was like a A2 size sheet. So he used to sit on the floor. So I spread it around him. So when I started explaining, he just asked me to hold on and he kept looking at the design. He looked at it for about 5 minutes. And then he said, you start. And the moment I started, he closed his eyes. And now this description has to be totally different. You have to tell him it, the whole design had to be told like a story. And within that story, he kept telling me things that, you know, you move it here, you add this, why not, why can't. So after I had completed, he said, yeah, I'm fine with the design, but you need to spend more time with me, understand what is happening here, how the life unfolds right from morning till evening in a typical Gurukul where the Kathak is being taught. So the good thing happened to me is that I had the opportunity of visiting him for 3-4 days, and I would spend considerable, about maybe half a day with him, and did talk to him about a lot of other things. For example, something which could be described in about 3-4 hours, the difference between Indian and Western dance. So I asked him, ki, what is the difference? He said, ki, you know, sometimes if you are sitting in front of a deity and you have got a diya in front of you, and the diya, you know, if you just watch the flame of the diya, you would find that with slight movement, the intensity of light changes. the deity, which might just be a rock, comes alive with the light changing intensity. The flame moves, sways. Every time it does that, the color of the flame also changes. And then finally it reaches a equilibrium. So he said, this, the movement of the flame and whatever the flame which goes on around that is like an Indian dance. And when it flickers in high intensity wind, it is like a Western dance. So this project could not have happened, did not happen because there was, you know, this was a government funded project and there were so many governments were changing in UP that the land which was to be awarded to him was not done. And for a long time, I think that project did not happen. Sometimes around 1994, we had an opportunity to work for the Ambi Valley project. I had not met Sahara Shri, but we had done a project in Lucknow, which did not happen. And he had seen my sketches and he had seen my design. So while this project was happening at Ambi Valley, he asked whether you would be interested in doing the landscape. That time we were referring to about 400 acres of land. So all of a sudden it was a big leap because we had only done projects which were like 3 acre, 4 acre, or maximum 6 or 10 acres, but nothing beyond that. So when I had to meet him, incidentally, the good thing which also happened is that before I met him, we had already started working at Ambi Valley and for about 4 months. So in that 4 months time, I had made myself familiar with the site, understood the house, what is the impact of the rain, the soil, the vegetation, and the topography. And incidentally, when he came across, you know, some amount of landscaping was happening at the site, and then he wanted to find out who is doing the landscaping. So I was introduced to him for the first time, because before that he had only seen the sketches, we had never met. So when I met him, I thought that he's going to ask me about my past works, and very likely I'm going to lose this project because, you know, there was nothing significant that we had done, passing out in 1990, probably starting the practice in 90, and this project coming across in 94. So I just waited for him to ask, and I thought he's going to ask me what has been your past experience. But I was surprised when he said, "Ki, how long you have been visiting this site?" I told him for nearly about 4 months. He asked, "What is the vision of your project?" And based on what I had told him, he said that you are going to be a landscape architect. And we continued doing that landscape for nearly about 10 to 15 years. When I'm talking about me, I'm referring to my whole staff, all people who have helped, friends, our complete staff who has been a pillar of strength all these days, right from 1990, because in isolation, this person just can't do anything. The interesting part which happened at Ambi Valley was when the chairman asked me, what is the vision of this project? Something, you know, because we had not had any experience of doing something on that scale, that too on a hilly site, which was already very, very scenic. So followed the first principle, learn from history if you don't know. So I had seen some of the pictures of Inca civilization had completely amazed me. At SPA Delhi, we had some books which were pretty large, and they had these various pictures of Inca civilization, beautifully done, and each element, whether it was a gateway or some structure, was extremely monumental and symbolic. There was nothing which was done, you know, in a disheartened way or which didn't make an impact. Even a stone which was kept on the walkway site had an impact on the people. So when he asked me the vision, the first thing I told him is that this particular site has to be done or looked at on a monumental scale. We need to tell the people the first impact on them should be absolutely, they should be knocked down by what they see at this particular site. Everything should be done on a, when I said monumental scale, what I meant is that we are not going to have beds of flowers. We are going to do flowering as agriculture. We would have water streams running all over. Everything would get tied up accordingly. In the bottom picture, you see the Shivaji Fort, which was a notable feature at site, because this is the only thing which you tend, wherever you might be in that 10,000 acres of land, this feature always exists. So I would say that in my life, the only project I designed where I have not had a single mound is this. Because when you have mountains, you don't need to make mounds. And Ravindran Ji used to say that, you know, these mounds are like pimples on the face of a man. So he would shape the land in a very different manner. So at Ambi Valley, it was an absolute experience. We were learning on daily basis, because this was a place where I found that the pressure of what rainfall would tear apart the leaves. The intensity of rains was understood by us for the first time. And if we didn't design it properly, the whole area would get eroded. So instead of learning sustainability by textbooks, we were forced to learn by observing, because we had no other way to deal with it. So what we had done at Ambi Valley and what I had talked about is visible in these pictures. These are the live photographs. The water bodies that you see are natural, not natural lakes, but the valley have been dammed to create these lakes where we have every kind of recreational activity. There are club buildings, there are log huts, there are a lot of other things. But the lesson to be learned is that you need to deal with the water in a very different manner. And even if you do very minimal, carefully do the planting, the landscape will show by itself. The next person I would like to talk about is Ustad Bismillah Khan. This particular building that you see in the backdrop is one of the buildings in which we were involved with the conservation work. And I had spent about almost with one more person. There were in fact three of us who had spent almost a week measuring this building, because there were no existing drawings available. So we measured this building height-wise, length-wise, width-wise, cut section through them. So while I would suggest to every person who is here, who is an architect, that once in your lifetime you go to Varanasi, spend about a week, watch these ghats in the morning, evening, watch the aarti. Whatever that you need to know about landscaping, you will learn it here. There's nothing which you would not learn. Everything that you would, that's why I would say that, you know, external knowledge, if you want to really integrate with your inner feelings, this is the place to be. And I realized that every time when Professor Shaheed talked about learning from history, I realized that if we have to look at the finest riverfront development example in the world, this is the place. So every historical site has lots to say. And though we did not do any work for him, but just meeting and being able to sit with him for some time was a great feeling. One interesting thing which he told us, actually we used to go to his, he was living on these ghats only. So very occasionally we used to just walk down here to see whether he's there or not. One day we realized that, you know, we could hear the shanai once we got closer to the river. And then we moved, we knew that he is playing somewhere. And when we met him, we told him that, you know, we could hear the shanai. And he said something very interesting. He said that you can hear the shanai almost 2 kilometers away. Or even not. He says that the sound travels on the surface of Ganges. And it could be heard almost 2-2.5 kilometers away. The villagers say that they can hear him play. He had a very description of Prayagraj, the Kumbh Mela. He was fascinated by that. He said, you can just use 4 materials and create a town for about 3 lakh people. You know, what you need is just bamboos, canvas, and metal sheets, and you can create a place for 3 lakh people. And here he was fascinated by these stones, which is called the Chunar stone. And he would always say that in the Shiva temple, the stone which is there is the same stone which is in the ghats. So he said, if you touch the stones of the ghat, you have actually been to the temple. Another project, when I had the opportunity to meet Amitabh Bachchan, we were asked to design a complex for Harivansh Rai Bachchanji at Noida on a 20-acre site. So this had to be done almost on a day's time, because they said you have one day to go and you have to make this design and next day give a presentation to Amitabh Bachchan. So overnight, there was not much that we had known about Harivansh Rai Bachchanji, but what I had heard or read about him at some stage in my life is that we used to do a lot of tuitions during the daytime, and in the evening you would go along the ghats of Allahabad on the river end, and most of his creative writing work was done on the ghats of river. So we had translated that same experience. This was a center for the arts, and these various buildings that you see are for different kind of art. There's literary art, poetry, literature, photography, movies, everything was put there. So this presentation was given to Amitabh Bachchan. He looked at everything. He was quite satisfied by the fact that, you know, we had created the ghat and we had created a rustic ambience. So a few things which are just listed here. The only mistake that he made, which he objected to, was the fact that we had put the Harivansh Rai Bachchanji on a pedestal. He said that my father would have never liked ever in his lifetime to stand on a pedestal. He just wanted to be with the people. So remove that. He said that all the buildings and the rustic ambience that you are talking about should be, can be as rustic from outside, but from inside they have to be absolutely modern, technically sound. He said that I don't want a celebration to happen in this place. It can be a place for peaceful contemplation where the people can just sit quietly, do the creative work. It's not a celebration place. And one more thing, which one amazing experience he shared with us. He said that, you know, there is a place dedicated to Lal Bahadur Shastri somewhere in Russia, I think in Leningrad Square, where Shastriji is standing on a 3 inches high platform. So he says the platform might be about 8 feet by 15 feet. And just 3 inches from the surrounding flat land, the place was created. And he has said that I have not, with hundreds of people walking around, I have not seen a single person who was stepping on that platform. And Shastriji was just one with the people around. So he said that we, Harivansh Rai Ji's personality should be reflected in a similar way, how he wanted to be. And the lesson to be learned from here was that whenever you design for any personality, make sure that, you know, the character of that personality is felt in the design. Otherwise, every design is like, you know, Mahatma Gandhi's memorial. This is the competition we had done sometimes in 2005. We were shortlisted in the final three. And the objective here was to, we have 8 botanical regions and we wanted to cite them in the mandala form with the map of India in the center. And for example, we have the Western Himalayas. So the conservatory, the temperate conservatory, which relates to Western Himalayas or the Eastern Himalayas, is placed somewhere along that. So there's a place which is for the Indus Plain, there's a place for Malabar Coast, there are Central India, Deccan Plateau, Assam. So in Assam region, we had the Fern House and Orchid House. And then on the southern side, we had the Tropical Embassy. Lot of areas were used for the display garden, and then other activities like the taxonomy garden, economic botany garden, arboreta, etc. were cited. The interesting part was being able to understand that there are 8 botanical regions in India. The map of India ensured that the people are not lost. Even a child who is 5 years old would understand, he would be able to relate to the map of India. Otherwise, such large landscaped areas, a person would get lost within no time, unless and until there is something which is holding him, or a landmark with which he can relate to. The most challenging project that I had come across in my life, it looks like a very tiny project, but this belonged to a mine owner in Kishangarh, who is he's probably a millionaire or a billionaire, I would say. All the mines belong to him. And the first lesson he taught me in his life, he said that, you know, the plants have got so much of power that, he said, 3 years back, I was driving tractors in the mines, extracting marble from the quarries, almost like 80 feet below the earth. And 3 years later, he found that there are certain kind of plants, wherever they are found, you find a good marble down below. So when the new quarries were to be auctioned by the government, he pulled in resources from all places and he bought that entire piece of land. And that is like a gold mine which is fetching marble for the last 10 years. The whole of Kishangarh is dependent on him for the supply of marble, who just about 3 years back was driving tractors on the quarry fields. So when this house was designed by Romi Khosla, and we were asked to do the landscape. And this particular person, he said, ki, I would like to discuss the plan with you. Now, this was a smaller site, maybe about an acre or so, in which the houses were so big that they were occupying nearly 60% of the land. So there wasn't much to be done. But still, he said, ki, I would like to discuss the landscape with you. And when he actually turned up, he said, ki, the option I am giving you is that you can spend any amount of money that you wish. I said, I this point of time, I can spend even 5-6 crores doing the landscape. I'm talking about 2005 or so, or even earlier. He said, I can spend any amount, but my requirement is that I want to see at least about 2,000 birds at my site. Now, for a moment, I thought this project is impossible. I mean, how can you get so many birds at one place? You can't just capture them and have them. So we thought that, you know, we can have some fruit trees and feed the birds and probably let them come in. So finally, in the evening, I left for Jaipur. And while we were driving along that from Kishangarh to, you have to go by car to Jaipur and then take a flight from there. While we were driving on that road, they were all of a sudden along the embankment, I came across certain kind of certain trees, the date palm, with thousands of nets of weaving birds. So every tree had nearly about 50 or 60 weaving bird nests, which were hanging from the tree. I told the driver to let us just stop and explore. He said, "Kids, there's nothing to explore. In whichever tree the cats cannot climb, the birds make their nest." So we went closer to the trees and we found that wherever the moisture was higher on the soil, the trees had lots and lots of these birds, because there were trees all over, but wherever the moisture was present in the soil. So the driver told me that, you know, the birds get to feed in the moist areas and that is the reason they nest here. So I think we got the answer. We had planted palm trees here. I didn't have the courage to actually find out whether the birds have come or not. But sometimes I came to know that there are at least about 2,000 nests which are there all over. The owners really, they don't like anyone to come there because he thinks that the birds will be disturbed. But over 2,000 birds that he demanded, I would say that of all my projects, this would have been the most satisfying and successful project. What he wanted has been done, and it has been done in the most beautiful way. These are some of the projects. How much time do we have? Are we short of time? Harishi?
No, sir. You may continue, sir.
Okay.
You have enough time.
You know, presenting in this manner is... Yeah.
Rajesh?
Yeah, I'm hearing.
Rajesh, I just want a small break. Have your sip of water. I just want
to come back in 5 minutes time.
Inform
we'll join others. In okay. I think another half an hour we'll finish
all
it.
All the
I,
people.
You know, okay, let's continue. The people can always come back and, you know, vote.
Question.
So do you want me to continue or should we hold for some time? Take a break.
Sir, you can continue.
Okay, let's continue, I think. So this particular project is a theme park in Vrindavan. Now, one of the important considerations which the clients had and one of the bylaws that I had said for them, I said that I'll read everything about Krishna, but don't ask me to join ISKCON. They agreed and they gave me certain books. But before going, they had said, ki, if you want to understand Krishna, if you want to understand Vrindavan, there are set of parameters that you understand and experience first. This included the festivals which happen around the year. So they gave me a time of, you know, understanding Krishna for the next 5 years. They said, ki, you can start designing after 5 years. There's no great hurry on account of that. The basic concepts was to create 12 forests where Krishna had his pastimes. And there were stories attached to each of these forests, whatever he did or whatever activity which was performed and whatever that happened here. So our objective was to design a theme park with these 12 forests and various kind of activities. Interesting part of such kind of projects happening in your life, because you know, not many people get the opportunity while doing the basic projects are like, you know, you do farmhouses, you do group housing, you can do more and more. And then you can even go to the extent of doing some corporates. But those are very, very extremely routine projects, absolutely predictable. You know what the client wants and you just perform. These are the kind of projects where you have to do a reasonable amount of research. And if you want to be true to yourself, you need to read Bhagavat. So in that process of 5 years, I had read the whole of Bhagavatam. I had read the Gita. And we had made, and our office had made various trips and travels to Vrindavan to document the ghats, to document the streets of Vrindavan, and collect every possible literature which was available. Understanding ghats, pasture lands, river, streets, and the animals. And the most important thing we learned is that, you know, everyone respected the dust which was there. We generally tend to ignore it, but they probably had a feeling that the dust which was present is the dust on which the Krishna had walked. And they had a lot of religious inclination towards it. So dust was an equal important component of the landscape. So these are the various pictures of the suggestive images for the actual design of what the theme park is going to be. It might take many more years. The temple is going to be the tallest in the world, about 275 meters. And they have started with the piling work, and maybe it will take many more years for the temple to happen. As far as the theme parks are concerned, the planting of tree, etc., on the forest has already begun. And maybe when the temple comes up to a certain stage, we'll get started with these attractions which are present. Campus for SPA Bhopal. This was a competition which I had won with Ashutosh Agarwal Architect. And since I had lived in Bhopal for nearly about 4 years, so my understanding of Bhopal was a very different place. I don't know how many people who are attending here are from Bhopal, but one thing I am very sure is that they have not understood the topography of Bhopal. In my school days, you know, we had to understand what is a hill and what is a valley and what is plateau. So while I was talking to my father, there was a priest who had come to our house, and he said that regarding the valley, he said, Bhopal is a valley. He said, it's a valley in which you have dammed and created these lakes at various levels. There are smaller hillocks, and the area in between are dense forests which lead up to the, which have got these rivulets which are feeding into the lakes. So we, for this particular project, we had translated the same understanding of Bhopal as a valley with lakes, with so what the blue color that you see were the existing quarries which were there at the site, and we wanted that water to continue as in a valley surrounded by these hillocks and forest which is penetrating them. Unfortunately, the faculty and the people involved had a very different opinion on this concept. They were not ready to accept Bhopal as a valley because it looks more like an urban city. And the plan had undergone lots and lots of changes. The site which was quite elevated was cut down, and all these quarries were filled up with the soil which was extracted from different area. I think it was a great opportunity lost in being able to create a beautiful campus out of that place, the way it was manipulated and mishandled, I would say. We also had a great opportunity to work on a project for A.R. Rahman at Chennai. Now, this particular project was important to me, not because it was A.R. Rahman, but he had a very difficult kind of brief that was presented to us. There were a lot of teachers that he had in his academy at Chennai who are architects themselves. So they are teaching Western classical music, but they are themselves architects. So they had designed the buildings, but no one had actually planned a master plan on which these buildings would sit. So Rahman was not very confident, or he was not happy with the layouts which were made, although he liked the buildings individually. So the chance that meeting that happened between us, he made it very clear. He says that I want to have the old world charm in this campus. It should have the classical ambience of old universities which were there in various parts of the world. The building should have Islamic character, but they should be modern. And then you should respond to the climate of weather, the weather conditions of Chennai. So we had actually, the building character was decided more by studying the buildings of Turkey, because Turkey is almost on that edge of being Islamic and the Western influence of the European influence, which is seen. So the buildings are absolutely modern with that touch of Islamism. And this particular campus we had designed for him, he liked it very much. Unfortunately, I think there were some land issues and he is trying to resolve them for the time being, till such time that it happens. Reliance Corporate Park. Mrs. Ambani had been to Ambi Valley. One of the common link I thought between this place and Ambi Valley was that the clients would always visit such places in helicopters. So from the Ambi Valley experience, we had learned that, you know, it's in the hills when you work, it's not just important to be able to see the ground from at eye level. There are times when you're on top of the hill and, you know, people coming in helicopters, they have a very different kind of a feel or the how they read the landscape, which is down below. So at Ambi Valley, we were able to achieve because we understood that the third dimension also has to be looked at. So Mrs. Ambani had probably been to Ambi Valley and then they were trying to find out who had done Ambi Valley. So finally zeroed on us. And then we had designed this. They had some portion were already done earlier. But whenever I went to Reliance Parks in the initial stages of my career, so when I went sometimes about 5 or 6 years back, this project is ongoing, we are still doing it. I realized that there were hardly any activity on the outdoor lawns. So the people would be inside and they had so much of greenery all around in the campus and I would not find a single person. So I think the first thing that we wanted to achieve is the people working in the landscape. And this geo garden that we started for Akash, his, you know, his understanding, because we didn't, when this concept came into being of geo, we didn't know it was what geo, it is Hindi geo or geography geo or what kind of a geo were they referring to. But eventually understood that these are like spectrum bands with various colors. And that is this geo garden that we have created has got that carnival ambience. If you happen to be there on this campus, even at, let's say, 35 or 38 degrees temperature, you would find thousands of people moving around. So it has lots of eateries, lot of dining spaces, people move around. And I'm really looking forward to that time when the people will come and sit in the landscape and work from there once they are locked in. So these are the various images of various areas in Reliance RCP. One of the requirements which, in fact, we were actually told at the very beginning about the likes and dislikes of Mukesh Ambani. And they said that, you know, the landscape of Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia, they think that is all junk. So they made it very clear, don't ever talk about Singapore, don't talk about Thailand, don't talk about Malaysia. You have to just think of high-end Europe and high-end US and nothing beyond. So the lesson to be learned from this was that most of these places have snowfall. So wherever you have snowfall, the landscape is generally neat. You would have, you know, there are no ground covers, nothing. So it's a neat lawn, which is just spreading all over, robust trees and clean surfaces. So that is what we have tried to achieve to a great extent. And it has been very successfully done in all these examples that you see. The first one on the left side is this one is a cricket stadium. It's called Dhirubhai Ambani Cricket Stadium. The idea was to create a gate which looks strong just by virtue of having these steel members going across framing it. And rest of the areas are like cricket stadium. There's a learning development center and some corporate buildings. Learning from history, this particular project actually inspired us to even read about mythology and stories and how they could actually be made beneficial for the purpose of designing. So people who have been to Amravati, one story which would be told to everyone is that the Krishna River earlier used to come and almost, because this place is surrounded by smaller hillocks. So this river was coming and finishing off in this area. It would not get connected to the sea. So eventually, River Krishna or Krishnaveni had requested Arjuna to create a passage for her so that she could merge with the sea. And Arjuna had done that. So we had borrowed that Indian mythological story, had this bow and arrow pattern, and created a campus which was actually following that. Something, some lesson to be learned here was this: I did not meet Amma, but I definitely met the senior Swami there. And once I told him is that, you know, Arjun did the wrong thing by allowing the river to go and meet the sea. It would have been better if the river just flooded here and we had a large water body. Our water would not have gone waste into the sea. He did not agree to what I said. And he said that, you know, it is the fate of the river is to meet the sea. So there cannot be any discussion on that. Sometimes later, there is a very strong ecological reasons for doing, for the, it is important that the rivers actually meet the sea. You cannot just dam the rivers and store all the water and assume that, you know, no water is wasted going into the sea. We have to ensure that all the rivers are flowing into the sea. If that doesn't happen, the sea water will move inwards. So if the rivers are not connecting, for example, someone who has been to Gujarat would realize that the coastal Gujarat is, the saline water from the sea is actually penetrating the landmass. Because so much of water has been extracted, the fresh water from the land, that the sea water, saline water is entering into the land. So it's not unimaginable that over a period of time, we would have the whole of Kutch along the perimeter of Gujarat, which is, runs next to the sea. Because the moment the saline water enters into the freshwater stream, the whole thing is going to get, no vegetation could exist. So Swamiji, when he said ki it is the destination of the rivers to actually meet the sea, there was a reason behind that. We just cannot tap the water of the rivers and allow only the sewage or junk to flow into the sea. The fresh water has to go, otherwise the whole of the coastal belt of India will go for a toss if we are not able to feed the sea with the fresh water coming through the rivers. So anything that you ever think of in the, you know, which tries to create an imbalance in the ecology has to be studied in detail, because there are implications to be seen everywhere. Because of short of time, I'll skip these two projects. This was an architectural project that we had done. The objective was to create a plaza and a park and how they could be merged together in a corporate ambience. So more than the landscape, the architectural part was important to us. One lesson that I had seen after learning from all these examples of IT parks existing all over is that, you know, they have a underground car park everywhere. So then you just can't plant trees because you're doing it over the RCC slab. So in this particular area, the curved building that you see is a complete parking lot. So we had a multi-level car park. With shopping happening at different levels, so the people can just go and park behind the shops. And the whole of this central plaza was a huge landscaped area. So we had a plaza and a park, and we wanted to just combine the, or probably see the impact of the plaza and park coming together, or a forest and a hard paved plaza coming together. This is another project in Bangalore. We'll just try to finish in another 15-20 minutes.
No problem. Go ahead, Rajesh.
Yeah. No, people will get restless.
No problem. You take your time. No problem. You can. Yeah. You are at the now, at the end of okay. the show. No problem. Take your time.
So this is a project in Bangalore. I envy the landscape architects, including Mr. Nanu Shastri, whoever is in Bangalore, because Bangalore offers us the best possible climatic condition for the vegetation to prosper. And you would come to Delhi and work in Jaipur and you had it. You know, you would find that every region has got some kind of a problem. There is dust, there is, you know, water is polluted, there's gypsum somewhere, something else happening somewhere. There's not a patch of land which has got fresh water and a fresh soil and a fresh atmosphere. So while we work in the north, we are actually struggling with the climatic factors. While the landscape architects who are working in Hyderabad and Bangalore and such places have a lot of advantages, any coastal area for that matter, heat and humidity is what the plants need, and they are in plenty, whether in Chennai or all these coastal areas, Vizag, Kadiyam is the place where all the plantation happens. So we were given the theme of forest of well-being for this particular project. The idea was to create or integrate forest in a corporate ambience and make use of sculptures, etc., to add to the story. So this is one project we had. We had collaborated with the forest Shubhendu, who create these forests by the Miyawaki method. And the overall results has been exceedingly good. In the bottom picture that you see, the trees are might be about a year old, but they have grown nearly 20 feet in height. Density has been immense, and lots of birds have already started nesting in these areas. So there's a good opportunity to follow these Miyawaki methods, etc., integrate them in the corporates, so that we don't have the same kind of barren, uninteresting landscape that we have all over Gurgaon and Delhi. Meeting, in fact, this project had started, we had started the work on it, but unfortunately our meeting with Tata Trust Chairman Ratan Tata could not happen. Nevertheless, based on whatever we had designed, we got some kind of feedback from him. And his objective, which was very precisely given to us, and he is one person who believes that sustainability and livelihood enhancement has to go together. Sustainability is one word which is grossly misunderstood. Everyone has got his own concept. Every landscape architect thinks that he is a sustainability expert, without having any kind of understanding of what it means. So this particular project was in Nimaligarh. This is in Assam. And whenever I get a project closer to my place of birth or my childhood places, I really enjoy it. You would probably find the best highways, you know, when you go from Guwahati, drive along the Brahmaputra and go to Arunachal Pradesh. These are some of the finest drive that you can ever come across in your life. The openness which is felt here. So this particular area was about 200 acres of land in which there are wetlands, because these wetlands are all, they are called Beel, and they are the offshoots of the rivulets of Brahmaputra. So every rainy season they get flooded and not being utilized in a proper way. So Tata Trust is spending a lot of money, effort, energies to educate the people, participate with them, invest in them, improve their livelihood, and professionally do what fishery could mean. Because if you know, in this piece of water that you see, the yield of fish could be increased almost like 100 times if we do it in a scientific manner. Whereas the people are just getting about 1% of the yield which they are actually getting. So when you have this kind of water around the year provided by nature, there is immense possibilities of the people's involvement, because the fishing cannot be done by a company and the money is distributed to the poor. Tata Trust always believes in including all these villages into its fold. So those are the people who are given the land where they actually have, they are given all the scientific and details for the fishery to be happening. We have a turtle sanctuary happening here. We have a lot of activities were proposed, in which we had also proposed this area being very close to Kaziranga National Park. We had also designed a hotel for Taj. And hopefully someday we'll get to see it happening when the project starts. This is a project, the most difficult project site, I would say, that I have come across in my life. We always believe that beyond, let's say, 10%, the land is unbuildable. But this particular site had a 50% slope. It's almost like the land is at 45 degrees. And the credit number one should go to the structural consultant who has made this building happen. Second number, the architects of Rupal Ghosh, who designed this building in such a beautiful way. And some amount of credit to us who actually positioned the building correctly. So all these cottages, etc., that you see are so well positioned that the overall impact after this whole thing has happened. And the biggest advantage that you can see those cascading trees next to the building. We have been able to retain or protect nearly 70% of the vegetation which was there. So some trees were transplanted, about 70-80% were protected. And I think this property would be one of the most beautiful ones from the perspective of hotels, because this is in Chael, and Chael is still the hill station which is absolutely undisturbed. The topography is so difficult that there is hardly any scope for the hotels to be built here. You need to have real strength to be able to even plan to build something on a land which is in which we could not even stand, because if a roll, if a stone rolls down from the hill, it will just come to the road. And then this, over that piece of land, this entire building has come up. Harishi, can we go to the next? It's not moving. Yeah, so another 15 minutes. Learning from all my professors. One person, we have already talked about Nanu Shastri. I had known him from the, you know, when I was doing my first year architecture, and his probably office was a training ground for everyone. It had a free entry, and everyone who wanted to understand architecture would always, you know, go into that office. Everyone was welcome. And we understood how the drafting is done, how the detailing is done, how the projects actually happen. It used to be in those days one of the most promising practices which were emerging, when you had people like Rajewal and, you know, big names. Out of that, all of a sudden, sometimes in 90s, we came across Nanu Shastri and Prasanna Desai, the most enterprising office. So since they were faculty members, we took the liberties and, you know, we went and discussed with them. Professor Shahir, I had worked with him for about 6 to 8 months, and then he was my professor in the college. The interesting part was that I worked with him when I used to be the only employee working there. And we worked on various projects. The most important one was a Kabir Samadhi at Maghar. And his approach has always been to do very minimalistic, do something very simple, earthy and symbolic, and which is drawn from history. The picture that you see on the left-hand side is actually a picture which he had it in front of him. Not exactly this picture, but the same place. And he always used to say that, you know, look at the bed sheets which are lying on the floor, and they just define the right kind of scale for a platform to be made around these kind of kunds. During celebration, this whole place comes alive. So he had a picture when the celebrations are happening, and picture on the other side, and this is what he cherished, this is what he designed. Professor Bhan, I am not sure how many of you have known him. I think if at all there is any credit goes for the developing this profession in India, it should probably go to him. I had an opportunity to spend about 5 hours while he was coming back from, we had gone for a NASA jury, and then we were coming back together in the same car. So in about 5 hours of time, I was trying to understand not his achievements, but everything else, his failures. You know, if you talk about the achievements, people go overboard and start explaining. But sometimes when you ever try to find out about the failures, and, you know, people have been knocked down and still they are standing. And Ravindabhan, I would say, is one such person who has not only made this profession, brought this profession to India, but he told the architects what is the importance of landscape architecture. And I think as the member of DUAC, he used to be a terror in those days. There has been no single architect who has been successfully who has dealt with Ravindabhan, except for Charles Correa and Doshi and Kanwinde. Everyone has been rubbed in the wrong way, and everyone has understood why the landscape architects are important in a project. Before the 90s, this profession was absolutely unknown, and everyone thought that it has more to do with horticulture. Professor Nalini Thakur, I had known her since when I was in third year architecture, and she introduced me to symbolism and monumentality. And these are some of the things and the cultural factors in the landscape and how conservation should be done. And I think this is something which had stayed with me. While I was doing everything else, I always had interest in conservation. And I felt that landscape architects can do a great contribution in the field of conservation. Professor S.D. Chhaya, he used to be, you know, he used to visit Mr. Shahir very occasionally, because Professor Shahir had only one friend. This I realized in about 6 months of working in his office. And Professor Chhaya used to visit him very frequently. And every day they had some arguments, some discussion, but very healthy ones. And I enjoyed every bit of that. Otherwise, I was a solitary person there. But every time Chhaya came, we used to have a tea party and discussions on various aspects of architecture. I was saying that we had won various competitions in India, and there was a reason for that. We had actually, I would say that nearly about 10 to 12 competitions we had won at different times. And there was a system that we followed. And I'm just sharing this so that, you know, any person or any student, so these are like five parameters which have to be considered in any kind of design. And depending on where you stop, you have to reach the stage six if you really wish to win the competition. So maybe at the first level, you want to make the landscape look visually strong. So visual might be function one. Functionally making it efficient is number two. Establishing the relationship between open and built form, all of us do that, is number three. Addressing all the ecological concerns of the site is going to be number four. Responding to the surroundings and to the culture of the place, so that, you know, the material that we use, the technology that we use, everything relates to the cultural factors is important. And the final thing which I always talk about, reading history, because, you know, only if you have understood history, you would understand what symbolism means and whatever concept you have, because the competitions are won on the basis of the symbolic image of the concept. So if your understanding of history is strong, your designs are bound to be strong. So I would say that to all the students who are aspiring to be landscape architects, learn from history. But every time I say learn from history, don't mistake me, because I'm not saying that you recycle the ideas taken from the history. While I was coming with Ravindra Bhan from Hisar to Delhi on a 5.5 hours drive, one thing I had asked him, what is the biggest difference that he sees from the time he was practicing and what is happening today? And the word he used is that earlier it used to be more of ecology and detailed designing, and now it is more of gimmicks. And sometimes I also feel that, you know, coming from a place, you can see the pictures on the right. This is the land from where I come from, and landed in Noida, which is, you know, culturally it is so poor. But any place in India which is culturally rich cannot have these just geometrical patterns. So we as landscape architects have to get out of that pattern making and gimmicks and seriously look at landscape. Every region in India, every area in India is culturally so rich that if you just learn from there, you don't have to look anywhere. Then I find that, you know, we had talked about the visually it should be strong and should be culturally rich. Sustainability is one word which I have found that it's like landscape architecture is absolutely misunderstood. No one really knows. If you have to water the plant or a tree, we don't even know where to put the water. You would have seen that during the rains, if you just observe a tree, the branching or the form of the tree allows the water to fall at a certain place, which is away from the trunk of the tree. And that is the place where you need to water the trees. We need to nurture the soil. The trees growing well is just a consequence of that. If you take care of the soil, and when I'm saying soil, it is not the dust. It's a living media. There was a time when we had I had been to a site and I had to discuss it with Professor Shahid. And I told him that, you know, it's a barren site, there's nothing happening there. And I still remember Professor Bhan used to say that, you know, even if you see a single tree and if you see which way it is tilting, it will give you an insight into how the wind flows in that area. If you see cow dung, it will tell you everything about the health of the soil, whether it's a rich in microorganism or it is a dead soil. I would also say that every landscape architect should learn to collaborate. You know, what we are doing in isolation, we need to work with ecologists, we need to work with botanists. We might assume that we know everything, but what we know is, you know, it's like a tip of the iceberg. We have no understanding. For nearly in the 30 years of practice, for nearly 25 years, I used to do anti-termite treatment, not realizing that the amount of damage that does to the soil, killing every other microorganism which was present. But I did that because that is what we were taught. That is what I have been putting in the BOQs and my specification. And after working on the Miyawaki method, we realized that, you know, all these termites, every microorganism on the soil is actually working for the benefit of the soil. It is just that we have, once we do the anti-termite treatment, we remove all the predators. The termites tend to come back, but all, you know, the predators don't come back so easily. So once again, you will have the termite, but the soil is dead because there's absolutely nothing which is making it living. I think every landscape architect should look at the production of food. There isn't a single project where the people want the orchards to be there, a vegetable garden. Sometime back, we had a very interesting discussion with the HCL chairman or his son-in-law, I would say, in Lucknow, where they had a huge campus of about 100 acres and they want the landscaping to be done. And I had used a word which he didn't like, and probably we did not get that project. And I told him is that, you know, we are for the corporate parks, we are acquiring such huge tracts of land, which is absolutely criminal, because what we eventually do is we kill the agriculture and create lawns out there because we have parking. So I said, why not create these, let the agriculture fields remain and you build your house buildings and make a multi-level car park somewhere so that you don't have to, you know, excavate the whole of the land and make underground car parks. He probably didn't like the word, the criminal use of agricultural land converted into IT parks. But he, nevertheless, he said, ki, what you're saying is correct. It's not important for the IT parks to have lawns. They can have agriculture and vegetable farming and everything else. And I would say that everyone should learn from biodynamic farming, permaculture, Miyawaki method. Some of you must have done it by now. If you have not done it, indulge in it, because this is something which is, you know, it has more to do with agriculture, but it's important that you learn about it. Now, one thing which I would, this is the last slide. Plant your dreams like seeds and nurture the soil. They will sprout at the appropriate time. I have felt in my life that, you know, in the early stages, I used to, we didn't have Google and very limited amount of books which were available. Most of the books used to be very expensive. So what was available in the library was seen by us. But even in those days, I used to make a lot of sketches and I used to just stop them. And I found that there were times when the life has offered me so many opportunities, like in theme parks or Amby Valley, or that anything that I could think of, I can just use it in my landscapes. So that's why I say that, you know, don't expect that when you get the project, you will design it and you will have something spectacular happening. You have to think on a daily basis, document whatever you can. Nurture it, and whatever you have done, you will find. While I was in, we were doing very ordinary projects, but I used to dream of large scale projects. We had designed, you know, if I used to think of how the cities can be done in a very different manner. Although I knew that never in my lifetime I will design a city. But then we got an opportunity of doing Amby Valley, which is purely the structuring element of Amby Valley is the valleys and the hills. So there would be a master planner, but the basic structuring of such hilly sites can only be understood and done by a landscape architect. Thanks a lot, everyone.